So, today what I'd like to do is talk a little bit about spirals in nature and the geometry behind spirals, and then we're going to have you guys spend most of the time making spirals of different sorts. I'll begin by showing you some spirals, both in nature and in architecture and in my own work, and then we'll get quickly into actually making them yourselves, and I hope you find that interesting. At any point when I'm talking, feel free to ask questions. I'd love to be interactive if possible, so don't just, if you have a question, ask it. As I was saying last night, I think curiosity is a really important characteristic for the creative process, and I was one of those students that, you know, there's always that student in class that asks all the questions and gets kind of annoying. That was me. So I have to pay my penance now by being happy to answer questions from any students that do that. So don't hesitate. The only foolish question is the unasked question, as far as I'm concerned, okay? So spirals are very common in nature, and here we see a fern frond that's getting ready to unfurl. It's a spiral, and I'm kind of intrigued with spirals. I think part of why I'm intrigued with them is that they suggest growth by their very nature. They're also endless. You can't actually get to the beginning of a spiral or the end of a spiral if you do a spiral consistently. They're infinitely small and infinitely large, and I kind of like that about them too, I think. Anyway, here's a spiral from the plant kingdom, and we have from the animal kingdom, Nautilus, remarkable animal, makes these incredibly beautiful spiral-formed shells. We have spirals in the form of sunflowers. In this case, many spirals in here. You can see all sorts of spirals going on here in both directions. And I've spent a lot of time looking at this kind of spiral that I talked about last night. Other flower forms, artichokes, which are part of the thistle family, also have spirals. Pine cones have spirals. Cactuses, cacti. This is actually maybe my favorite plant in the world, the Romanesco broccoli, which is made up of spirals of spirals of spirals. It's a fractal. If you've heard of a fractal, heard fractals before, this is an example of fractal behavior in plants. Here's a spiral that's very relevant to you guys. And that's an actual photo of, I think, I don't know which hurricane it was, but I guess you get tired of naming them. You get so many of them down here, right? And very large scale spiral galaxies even, right? And then coming back to Earth, we have human-made spirals. A classic example being the Greek Ionic Column, which has this characteristic sort of ram's horn spiral going on. And of course there's spiral staircases. And the Swiss Re Tower in London, I don't know if it's Re or Ray. Anybody know how it's pronounced? Ray, Re, I don't know. Designed by Norman Foster, is a great example of some spiral geometry. Now, there's many different kinds of spirals, but two broad categories of spirals, and I hope you all have better vision than I do, you can see that. Two kinds of spirals that many spirals fall into the category of are an arithmetic spiral or an equilateral. It's the short of the word equal angular. Think of it as a spiral that has equal angular. That's driving me crazy. I've got to find out. Can somebody Google equal angular spiral? we'll just live with it for now. So these two kinds of spirals, maybe I'll stand over here, show you that. An arithmetic spiral, the thing you'll notice as you compare these two is that the distance between these two, like if you look at two sort of parts of the spiral, that distance remains the same as I go around here. Do you see that?
Yeah.
Right? Now that's not happening here. Do you see how it's getting smaller, bigger, 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 bigger? So that's one of the key things that distinguishes these two kinds of spirals. We're going to make both kinds of spirals. The reason that they're called equal angular, I've got to get the right word. This is driving me crazy. hold on, let's see what the word is.
Equal angular.
Is it equal angular?
No, because they're not equal.
No, it is equal angular is what it means, but I...
Equine is called horse.
Yeah, and the horse's tail gets smaller and smaller, like equine.
Oh, I don't have a...
Yeah, because it's sort of...
I don't have a connection here. You guys, I can't do it. Can somebody look it up?
That's why it becomes smaller.
We'll just call it the equal angular spiral, because that's what it means. The word means equal angular. And it's a little, it's a sort of a subtle thing to see here, but it'll be easier to see once you've made them, that if you look at, see the crosshairs here? Can you see the crosshairs in the back of the room? I want you to look at where the spiral crosses the crosshairs, here, here, and here. And in particular, I want you to look at the angle between the crosshair, this horizontal crosshair, and this part of the spiral. And look at how it changes. You see how there it's kind of like that kind of an angle. Here it's more upright, and here it's almost 90 degrees. So the angle between the spiral and the crosshairs changes as it goes out, okay? Here, it remains exactly the same. This angle is always the same. Now, it may not, again, be super easy to see on this, but that's a fundamental aspect of a logarithmic spiral, is that it's also called the equal angular spiral. Because that angle remains the same, this one does not remain the same. And you'll be drawing this, and it'll become clear. So let's actually start with here's another example. This is an equal angular spiral as well. And here you can see maybe a little more easily that at each of these x, x2, x3, x4, and so on, that angle remains the same all the way around. And because of that, that's what causes the distance between the spirals to get greater as it goes out. So let me just show you a couple examples of my own work that use almost exclusively equal angular spirals. And I also tend to like to have things that move. I'm sort of interested in the aesthetics of movement. And so this is a spiral that can roll up and unroll with just pulling on a string. And one of the characteristics of an equal angular spiral is that every part of it is what we call in mathematics, they're similar. And all that means is it's a shape that the two shapes that are the same shape but different size are called similar. They're not identical, they're not exactly the same, but they're the same. It's sort of like if I had a big hand and a little hand, those would be similar. These hands are actually what they call, these aren't the same anyway because I left the right hand. Notice that the pieces on this spiral are all the same shape, just a different size. Here's another example of a spiral, and maybe this makes it even clearer. If you look at this, how this is made, it's made up of a bunch of almost square pieces, or slightly warped squares. And this shape is the same as this shape, is the same as this, is the same as this, same as this. And that's what we mean by similar. They're all the same shape but a different size, okay? Also, in this case, I actually built this, constructed this by laser cutting wood, and all of these pieces came out of this piece. This frame fits exactly in that one, this fits in that one, so they are actually all cut out of that one piece, and then I attached them together with cloth, tape, and glue to turn them into something that could actually transform, and here you can see what happens with that. Sorry, the image is so small, I hope you're able to see it. And then I made another version of this that's very similar, except that I've connected the two sides on the outer radius rather than the inner radius. And here you'll be able to see my hands actually activated it by pulling it apart. And together, I'm able to force it to curl up or to uncurl, depending on that angle between the two sides of the spiral. And even though it's just a bunch of hinges, the thing that's surprising to me anyway is that when you have that many connections, it starts to look like it's sort of more organic rather than mechanical structure, right? Here's an example of a spiral that I designed with very specific angles so that it can sort of fold up on itself. In this case, it's folding flat around onto itself with every two pieces. Here, every three pieces fold around to the same place to make a kind of a triangular prism. And when they all get folded together, what you end up with is a sort of a spiral tower. And I was pretty happy with this. I liked the idea that it would transform between this kind of graceful spiral and this more structural thing. But as part of my sort of insatiable curiosity, I was playing with it one day and wishing that it did more. I had no reason to believe it should do more. But in fact, it had this characteristic, which these spirals are showing, which is that if I lifted it up, it would actually sort of magically rise up, seemingly against defined physics, but actually obeying the laws of physics to do this. This is a different version of the same idea. It just naturally wants to sort of rise up like this. There's no strings attached or anything like that. That's just its natural preference. And so I'd like to now let's go ahead and get our hands dirty, so to speak.
Yeah.
And everybody gets a sheet of one of these pieces of paper that has the what I call spokes on them. And everyone should have everyone's got a pencil and a pen. All right, everybody has all right, so everybody should have a sheet with the gray spokes on it and an index card and a pencil and a pen would be great. Everyone's got that, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Great.
You have what?
I have a pencil.
A pencil should be fine, actually. That's probably a better choice. So what we're going to do is we're going to now draw we're going to draw a logarithmic spiral. Okay, question. Like the spokes right now are 22.5 degrees apart. Is that an important amount? Well, in one sense, yes. It's helping determine how the spiral comes out. But I just wanted to make enough spokes that had sort of a decent distance between them, but had them close enough together to make a kind of continuous spiral. Because even though we're calling this a spiral, it's kind of a bumpy spiral, right? It's not super smooth. And that's because it's very difficult. But I don't know how you would draw a nice smooth spiral by hand. It's just approximate. That's exactly how you. Each any point along the spiral, it has the same angle relative to the axis going into the center. And since you've been using this card with its right angle, you know that the angle is the same every single spoke, right? It's always been 90 degrees, at least where you're starting it. Okay, now let's say we wanted to make a spiral that grew faster or grew slower. How could we change that? Well, we could change the angle that it crosses the spoke at. This is a little bit of an experiment. I don't know if this is going to work well or not. But what you can do is if you want to take your card and cut it at a slightly different angle. Watch what I'm doing here. I'm just going to cut a little.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-oh. I didn't cut that very straight. I'll make a better job. I've now changed that to that angle. And if I use that, I'm going to get a different spiral. And actually, to be safe, I think I'm going to cut it and then use this as your angle with your spoke. I didn't put that break through. What I mean is, if you cut your card like this,
so the wider angle?
So that's going to make it grow faster, yeah. So let's do that. The reason I don't want you to make it go slower is that if you did the angle too much, it would end up being a circle. Make it just slightly off of right angle, something like that, say. Okay? And now, you're going to use that card and hold it up here and draw the line. Hold it up, draw the line, hold it up, draw the line, hold it up, draw the line. Okay? Yeah, that'd be a great way to make one of these. So did everybody get everyone's got two different kinds of spirals out. That's good, that's a very fast spiral, which is fine. That's quite fast.
I'm still in the beginning.
Hey, good.
What? Are we supposed to continue? No, we're not supposed to continue. We're supposed to start.
Okay.
Or you do is best to start at the beginning, a very good place to start.
Let's work on making an arithmetic spiral. And to do that, we're going to use very different tools. I'm going to come around with some string. You need, you know, one piece of the table, just cut it in half. There's only two.
Is the tape still coming around?
Yeah.
Pass on the tape if it's sitting by.
How do you want it?
That's good.
Yeah, we have a good member. Let's go fishing.
You guys need
each group just needs like an.
Anybody want to see what it looks like?
Oh, yeah.
We're basically just attaching the string so that, you know, it holds on reasonably. Okay? So, spread like that. And you want the washer to be. It doesn't, the exact amount actually isn't important, but I'd make it about, if you've got a foot of string, make it about a foot away. About a foot away from the end of the dowel, okay? And tie it.
Is there more string?
Is there more string? I almost don't know.
What did it say?
About a foot away from the dowel.
Yeah, that's like that.
And it's going to cut off the extra string. Just hold that nice and straight. And then, one of you, the third of you, so one of you's holding the paper, one of you is holding the dowel. The third one of you is going to put the pencil, or the pen or pencil, in the washer and start going around. Okay? Does that make sense? And watch Ashley as she's doing this. Now, she's going to run into a problem because she's going to run into, what's your name?
David.
She's going to run into David's hand. So Ashley needs to use two hands. Watch like this. You're going to go like that. And then like that. So you want to do that, Ashley? So it takes a little bit, it's a little bit tricky because you got to get around the other person's arm. She's doing just great. Excellent.
Yeah, it looks like a spiral. Here.
Okay.
What do you want to do?
Are you ready?
Do you want to use a pen? Oh, I don't know. Are we supposed to do that? Yeah, he said pen. Can we put it in the center?
Tell me where it's centered.
So the string should be at the bottom of the dowel.
Yes, the string should be at the bottom of the dowel, not the top of the dowel.
Okay, there we go.
Yeah, there
we go. Watch your dowel.
You have two hands.
You're moving, man. Come on, hold it down. Hold tight. There you go.
Throw
it up. We win.
Nuh-uh. It's not a race.
No, it's the one that finishes second.
Just like, yeah.
Take your time. That's for a
roll.
That's perfect.
You want me to hold
it down?
Our spiral has a few bugs.
Yeah.
One of them is that we're still in one hand.
Basically look the same, right, in terms of the distance between the spokes.
Yes.
So can somebody tell me what's determining that distance between each of the lines in the spiral?
The unrolling,
the
angle,
the
diameter of the dowel.
Extend the thread, it gets the angle changes.
Circumference,
right,
of the dowel.
The thread gets longer. Mm-hmm. So what determines how quickly that thread gets longer?
Your
what about the rod?
The diameter of
the rod. Right, so let me ask a more specific question.
We're good.
What does that distance represent on the rod? What?
Similar.
So it's not this much distance, right?
Yeah.
What does that represent on the rod?
Wow, it's a ratio.
The radius.
It's the circumference. It's the circumference of the rod, right? Because every time it goes around once, it goes around one whole circumference, and that's the increased distance out. Okay? So what do you think is going to happen if you make a fishing rod with that thinner dowel?
It'll be a
tail. Are you sure?
No.
Well, as I mentioned, some spirals are just single spirals, much that's what you've been drawing now, but it's also often the case that spirals happen in these kinds of clusters, as in flowers, like sunflowers and this other tropical flower, the name I don't know, artichokes, and pine cones, and in all these you can see multiple spirals, particularly, say, in the upper right corner of that, the pine cone in the upper right corner, you can see these spirals. You see spirals in pineapples. And although these are all, you know, very different entities, they do have this similarity of having these multiple spirals. And you might ask yourself, like, is there a similar process that nature uses to make these? And the answer is yes. Nature does, in fact, use a similar process to make all of these. Here's a succulent, for instance. Here's the Romanesco broccoli. So what is that process? Well, let's take a look. It's a very clever, simple and clever process that nature uses. So here we have a cactus, and if you look in the center, you can see where the next leaf is going to come out, and I'll put a dot to signify that. Now, if I were to ask you which is the newest leaf on this plant right now, where would you say the newest leaf is, the one that just most recently came out of the center?
The one cradling
it. So which one?
The bottom right.
The bottom right, right, just to the lower right of that center dot, right? And let's go ahead and mark that with a 1. I'm sorry it's so small to be seen for you guys over there. Where's the next newest leaf? Just above the center, right? Is that pretty clear?
Yeah.
Okay, we'll mark that 2. What about the next newest? That gets a little harder to be sure about, right? But I'm gonna tell you that it's actually this one.
Yeah.
Okay? And then we're going to go 4, 5, and 6. The question is, how do we decide where the next ones are? Well, one thing you might have noticed is that I've actually been going in a circle right now. I've been going counterclockwise. And in fact, the next one is there, again, going counterclockwise. And the next one after that is going to be where? Well, the answer is, each of these is 137.5 degrees around from the previous one. So that We started here, we then rotated 137.5 degrees to there, we then rotated 137.5 degrees to there, we then rotated 137.5 degrees to there. So given that you know that the next one has to be 137 degrees counterclockwise, which leaf do you think it is? See if you can guess before I show you. All the guesses in? Did you guess right?
Yeah.
Okay, what about, where's number 6 going to be? You sure? You're right. All right, you're already getting the experts. Where's number 7?
Right above
4, that's right. And 8?
Left.
9? 10? So you get the idea. We're actually spiraling around. There's 11, one more for 12, and then 13 is there. And so we've been spiraling around like this, right? Now, if I hadn't told you that and I had just popped those up, you would think it was kind of random because they're so far away from each other. But this is actually a technique that nature uses. This construction technique is how nature constructed all of those spirals that I just showed you, every one of those. Even though some of them have lots of spirals, some of them have few spirals, they're all using that same technique. And what's interesting, scientists have determined that arrangement of leaves minimizes overlap. Why would you want to minimize overlap?
More sun absorption.
More sun absorption, right. After all, leaves are solar collectors, so you want to minimize the overlap, right? It also makes for the best way to pack things together if you're putting seeds on a seed head. That sounds sort of counterintuitive, like if it minimizes overlap, why does it also allow for packing tight seeds? That's just the way it works out. It's a very symmetrical treatment. So just to reiterate, I don't know if you can see this here, but this angle that it's doing, this 137.5 degree angle, is called the golden angle because it's based on something called the golden mean or the golden ratio. And it's a very powerful ratio. It's such a powerful ratio that in mathematics they've given it its own name, its own Greek letter called phi. That's the Greek letter phi. What other important What other important ratios or numbers in mathematics have their own Greek letter? Anyone think along that?
Pi.
Pi, that's right. So when something's really important, they get their own Greek letter. That's how you know it's important. Well, phi is that important. It has its own Greek letter. And all of these, they all have spirals. The numbers of spirals are different. So the question is, well, if they're all made with the same technique, how can they all have different numbers of spirals? Like this one, you can see, has, has maybe 10 or so spirals, I'm not sure. But this has many, many more spirals. How can it be that these are made by the same process? Well, it ends up that that same process can lead to different numbers of spirals, but it doesn't lead to an arbitrary number of spirals. You'll find that any of those plants you go out and look in nature, if you count the spirals, they are always going to be something called Fibonacci numbers. What are Fibonacci numbers? Well, the Fibonacci numbers are made from something called the Fibonacci sequence, which was discovered by Leonardo Fibonacci late 12th century. And to figure out what the Fibonacci numbers are is as easy as 1 and 1 equals 2. What could be easier than 1 and 1 equals 2? Well, the way you do it is you start with 1 and 1 and add these two together. 1 plus 1 equals 2. You then add the next two, 1 plus 2 equals 3, 2 plus 3 equals 5, 3 plus 5 equals 8, 5 plus 8 equals 13, 8, 13, 21, and so on. And those are the Fibonacci numbers. And you will find that those numbers are the number of spirals you will always see if you look at a pine cone, a sunflower. If you count those spirals, it's always going to be one of those. Yes? Question?
Also, sometimes there are mutant varieties which use other Fibonacci.
You are absolutely right. And I wasn't going to mention that, but he's absolutely right. There are mutants. And so I shouldn't have said always. But almost all the time, you will find that they are those numbers. The mutants tend to be, by the way, doubles of those, if they are not Fibonacci numbers. Though there's probably exceptions to that as well. Just one last little bit of sort of, you might wonder, well, why is it that the golden ratio and phi leads to Fibonacci numbers? I mean, how are they connected? Well, they're very tightly connected. It's a very rich relationship. I'll just mention one thing, which is that if you divide any of these neighboring Fibonacci numbers, like 3 divided by 5, 5 divided by 8, 8 divided by 13, these are all good approximations for phi. Remember, what was phi? Phi was about 0.618, I said, 0.618. Well, 2/3 is 0.666, which is a little more than 618. 3/5 is, I can't even remember what 3/5 is. It's a little less than 0.618. 5/8 is a little more, but closer still. And each of these gets a little bit closer to being an approximation for phi, and that's not a coincidence. I'm not going to explain why that is, but I just wanted to draw your attention to that. Okay, so let's take a look at some examples. Here's the sunflower. I counted the spirals on this, and you'll have to take my word for it, but there I counted 34 spirals going in that direction, and in the other direction, there are 55 spirals. Notice also that when you see these spirals in plants, you'll always have spirals going in one direction and then spirals in the other direction. You'll never have just spirals in one direction. Maybe I shouldn't say never, but almost never. I've never seen it happen. And they're always neighboring Fibonacci numbers. So in this case, it's 34 and 55. You would not tend to see like 21 and 55, but 34 and 55. Here's a pine cone. We see 8 spirals in one direction. How many in the other? We see 13. And this is a very common number of spirals to see in plant forms, 8 and 13. And so I decided to use this as a starting point for my own investigations of making spirals. And so I used the same technique that nature used to lay out numbers and create a spiral based on those numbers where I chose to connect the 8s and the 13s. And I ended up with something like this. Okay? And now you guys are going to do that same thing without the use of a computer, paper, a thumbtack, and a specially designed template. You're going to stick the push pin right through the center of the paper. And once you stick it through the center of the paper, take your piece of tape and put it on the back to hold it in place.
On the sharp side?
Will they be flipping it? No, not on the sharp side. You want to hold it on the back side.
Will they be flipping it here?
So you're going to be turning it over. You're going to be turning it over so the pin faces up.
Yeah. If you see red, then you can just...
The tape is just to hold things in place. And then you're going to place your template on top of that. See the hole here in the corner of the template? Place that so that you can read the thing correctly. Place that on the pin. You might have to push, it's gonna be a little snug. Push it down onto the pin. We're using the pin as something to rotate around, that's what we're doing. Okay? This is 137.5 degrees here. This is the golden angle, designed to be the golden angle. And this is going to let you make a logarithmic spirals. And one of the ways you can see that they're logarithmic is that the distance between these points is not equal distance. It starts out larger and gets smaller. Here, this is point number zero. We start at zero for reasons I'll explain later. That's point zero. If I go counterclockwise, where's point one? I'm sorry. On the previous example, we started from the center and went out. Here we're going to start from the outside and work our way in, just because it's easier to start. It's just easier for the construction process, but it's the same idea. So instead of starting in here, we're starting out here and we're moving in, going counterclockwise. So if this is point zero, where's point one?
Three over. Right there.
That's right. That's point one. Where's point two?
Three over.
It's right there. And you're gonna. That's and what I did is when I went from that point to that point to that point. I reduced the distance from here to here by 2.8%. You see on here I've written 2.8%? That's how much I reduced to get to that point. When I rotated 137 and I reduced 2.8%. Rotated 137, reduced 2.8%. And I kept doing that to get all my dots. And that's what you're going to do now. We're going to begin just like we did there on the right side. And here's where the teamwork comes in. One of you is going to be the dot drawer, one of you is going to be the number drawer, and one of you is going to be the template mover, okay? I'm going to do all three for now, but then I'll set you guys up and let them watch you do that. So the dot person goes to zero, puts a little zero right at what would be 3 o'clock, if this is 12 o'clock. You put it at 3 o'clock, and the number drawer draws the number there, which is zero next to it. And the dot person holds their pencil there, and the template person takes the template and rotates it around until it hits the pencil flat like that. Then the template person holds the template, the dot person goes over, and we do zero first. Now we're drawing one. We go to the one, make a little smudge of a dot there, hold that in place. The number person draws one next to that. The template person, you want to be the template person? Pull the template around. Great. Make sure that it's flush with next to the pencil. Hold that template in place. I now go over, which is the next number? Two, so 0, 1, 2. I put a little dot there, I hold the pencil. Number person draws the number. Template person moves the template.
No problem.
Around we go. Make sure and maybe hold that. Make sure that's flat. Make sure that's flat too, template person. Okay, and then I go over, and I draw which number?
Three.
So that's 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. Is that making sense to you guys? So first of all, as we mentioned,
Alex
determined for us that this has 5 spirals in one direction and 8 in the other, and all. Just reiterate what he did. So by spirals, I mean this effect here. Do you see this, Louise, doing that? Does everyone see that spiral? So I'm gonna put my finger on that spiral, and then rotate this around and count them. So this is one. This is two. This is three. This is four. This is five. And now we're back to here. So that's 5, right? And now, but there's also spirals going this way. So I'm going to put my finger there and call that 1, 2, 3, 4, five, sorry, six, seven, eight, and then back to the zero. So we get five in one direction and eight in the other. All right? Again, not chambers. Now, it's actually important to do, that's part of the test, part of the trick for figuring out which way to open, to eat the artichoke. And why is, how can I explain that? So, remember that the way nature made this, nature didn't put down five spirals and eight spirals, nature did what you guys did, and it resulted in these spirals showing up. So, and notice that five and eight are neighboring Fibonacci numbers, and if the, this was the eight and this was the five, right?
No, the other way.
I got that backwards?
That's the five.
One, two, three, four, that's the five, and that's the eight. And what you, and what I'm gonna do, I'm not gonna completely explain this, but just take my word for it, I guess. I just don't want to take the time, but I'm happy to talk about it later with anybody who wants to. Is if that direction is eight and that direction is five, then I know that this direction is three, because there's actually a spiral here that's a three, although it's not obvious. And that direction is two, and that direction is one. And the reason I did that is I wanted to figure out which way to start peeling this off. And it ends up, and this is something I just discovered myself. I assumed that all artichokes for the same species would all turn the same way. They don't. If you go to the grocery store, they will all be fives and eights, but you'll find that in some of them, the fives are here and the eights are here, and some of them, the fives are here and the eights are here. And so I guess what that means is that at some very early stage of the development of the artichoke, it decides, it goes one way or the other, and it has to follow that system. But it can go both ways, so that's why you have to check this. So this is five and this is eight, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. So eight, five, three, two, one. Okay, so now I know that the one spiral goes this way as I go from outside to inside, which means if I look at this and I look at my very first leaf, if I wasn't sure which way to go, and by the way, sometimes you can tell, but it's not always clear, so it's helpful to have a starter. Like, here's my very first leaf, and I just said that one goes this way, where would the next one be? It would be 137 degrees around this way, and there we in fact see it. There it is. Another 137 degrees. We get that one. Another 137 degrees. We get that one.
But how many calories?
Before you figure out when to start eating, I would have finished the eating already.
Okay, so I'm now going to pull this one off. We're going to start right here. There's number one, zero. Number one. Number two. 137 degrees. Number three.
Wow.
137 degrees. Number four.
But you're not eating it.
It's not cooked.
I don't want to spoil my lunch. 137 degrees. There's number five. 137 degrees. Number six. 137 degrees.
Wow.
And another one. 137, and another one. And notice it's really important that I use the system here, because right now I could have chosen any of those if I weren't paying attention to my system. 137 degrees. 137 degrees. 137, I don't know what number it is. 137 degrees.
There goes a $5.
Oh, you know, I should have kept track of the numbers because.
How many leaves are on the ground?
You know what I can tell you with this? You know what? I just took this one off, and the very first one we took off that I called zero is here. So this one must be 13.
It's 13.
There's 12. There you go. 12. So that's 13. And you know what I can predict? I can predict that. Guess what that one's going to be?
21.
Should we mark it and see if I'm right?
Yeah, go ahead.
I'll put an X on it. Okay, see that X? Okay, 13. 14, 15, 16, I wish they were cooked so I could eat them.
Yes.
A little butter. 17, 18, I hope I do this right, I'm going to teach fast. 19, 20, And...
Technical
difficulties. Is that it? I don't even see my marks.
Well, your thumb is. That was it. This one.
We all have to do it.
That one with the little blemish.
Which one is it?
That one.
It was the 18.
That one?
No, that right. That one.
Is that one? Oh, is that one? You sure?
I'm pretty sure it's 12.
Well, good, because that's supposed to be 21.
Okay.
Okay. Can you see what's not?
Does it say 21 on it? Like
18.
I think you marked one lower than.
Oh, did I?
Because 18 is 3 times the
length. Oh, 8.
Yeah, you were just one down.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Yes, thank you. So,
okay, that would have driven us crazy all day.
Yeah, okay. So you get the idea. So that's the proper way to eat an artichoke, all right? I don't want to hear anybody eat it the wrong way in the future. Very disappointed.
Now
I'm just going to
be in the grocery store. Really.
Yeah. Okay, now I'd like you to go back to your tables, and we're going to look at what you've drawn here.
What do you mean? Four numbers closest.
Closest to zero. Any number that's under 24.
Yeah, the closest would be this one.
The difference between them. So tell me the number you picked.
17.
And what's one of the numbers that's closest to 17?
30.
Okay, what's the difference between 17 and 30?
13.
Okay, do it with the other three as well. See what the difference is between the neighboring numbers and the number.
The difference is 13. If this one is 13, so this one will be.
So now I'd like you to find. Let's go to your zero. Let's go to your zero. And very, very lightly with your pencil, draw. No, I have to decide what I want you to do here, to draw or not to draw. Very lightly, I'd like you, very light pencil, I'd like you to draw from zero all of the numbers that are 8. So 0 to 8, to 16, to. 24.
But with a straight edge, or
no, 24.
Adding
8. 0,
1,
2. You don't even need to draw. Just see it in your. Just look at it. Just look at it. Just notice what it is. Do you all see what's happening there?
0 to 8.
Those are all 8 apart, right? And how many of those spirals are there in this?
A lot.
That's the whole number.
So
is that a coincidence? There are 8 apart, and there's 8 of them. It's not a coincidence, right? Because they each use 1/8 of the numbers. Right? Look at the same for 13, from 0 to 13. You see a nice spiral there? 0, 13, 26, 39. You see the nice spiral there?
Yeah.
Okay. And how many of those spirals are there?
I mean 8.
There's going to be 13 of those. And which spiral is straighter? The 13 one or the 8 one? The 13 one is straighter. And that's always going to be the case with this. Whichever one there's more of is going to be straighter. So, but don't take my word for it. Let's drop down a Fibonacci number. We just looked at 8. We looked at 13. Let's drop down. What's the number before 8 in the Fibonacci sequence?
5.
Look at the 5s. 0, 5, 10.
13.
Is that one straighter or curvier?
Very curvy.
Much curvier, right? Okay. So far, I'm not telling a lie. They haven't detected my lie yet, if I am lying. I don't think I'm lying. I'm just reporting on the data. Let's go the other direction. What's the next one above 13? 21. So let's check out 0, 21. What's after that? 42.
Oh, that's super strong.
42.
And then 42.
Yeah. 0, 21, 42. What's after 42? 63. And what kind of curve are you getting there? Pretty straight.
Pretty straight.
You want to Or see if you can go 0 to 34. Well, that's getting a little high, though, right? 0 to 34. Yeah, this is the line. Okay. So, why don't you? Oh, and let's do. What's 8? What's 13 minus 8?
5.
5? Yeah, we did 5. Good. Okay. So, at this point, I don't know exactly what is the best thing to have you do at this point with these drawings. You can either, here's my idea, and there's no right answer. I'm just not sure because there's so much you can do with this. You can draw in the 8 and the 13 spirals if you want. You can draw in all four of the ones we just talked about if you want. For starters, though, why don't we do this? Starting at 0, I'd like you to draw just the 0 to 8, the 0 to 13, and the 0 to 8, 0 to 13, and then I'd like you to draw the just the 0 to 8, 0 to 13, and then draw the 8 to 21.
As a ruler.
8 to 21, and 13 to 21.
A curve?
You can do it in a curve, sure. Or you can use your straight edge, it's up to you. And that makes a little diamond shape, right? 0 to 8, 0 to 13, 8 to 21, and 13 to 21.
Is that a curve size,
that,
or
0
to
21?
No,
that's a curve. Yes, yes. Well, there are different versions. Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, and now I'd like you to draw 0 to 21. And 8 to 13. So, any of those lines can be continued all the way into the center if you want to. And let's take a few minutes, and you can choose which ones you want to do. Whatever line you draw, I would suggest you draw it for the entire spiral. In other words, if you draw the 0-8, do the 0-8 set, then do the 1-9 set, and then the 2-10 set. Does that make sense?
No.
I'm not sure.
You mean
go ahead.
Yeah.
Let's go. You know what? Let's all go ahead. I think it's best. Let's all draw the 0-8-16 spiral. If you haven't already done that, and if you have drawn that, now draw the 1-9-17 spiral. So, everybody look this way for a moment.
Yeah.
I want to talk about what's in your packets. So, I'm not sure what order you have them in, but what you'll find in each packet is, I think, 4 pieces of paper, maybe 5.
5.
5. And on all of them, on the bottom left corner, you'll see it says reduction rate and angle. And the angle is going to be the same on all of them because we're using the golden angle for all of these. The only difference. Actually, pull out of your packet the one that says 2.73 without lines on it. There's one that has lines, one that doesn't. Pick out the one that's 2.73, and pick out the one that is 1.1. 2.73 and 1.1 for the reduction rate. That's these two here.
No.
Now, this one, the two, has everyone got that? 1.73 and 1.1 reduction rate. Remember what the reduction rate means? That's how much you move in each time you move around 107 degrees. This one, the 2.73, is exactly what you just drew. It should look very much like what you just drew, right? The 1.1% is the exact same thing, except that I didn't reduce as quickly. I only reduced 1.1%. And if you compare the two, you can see that the 1.1 is much denser than the 2.73. But I want you to notice that any given number is in the same position in terms of its orientation around the center. So for instance, look at the top of the page at 6. 6 is in the same orientation, right? And then if you go to 19, below 6, it's also in the same orientation, but it's not as far away from 6 because it reduces quickly. You see that? So the only difference in these two techniques is how much I reduced. But I want you to notice, if you look at the 0 on the 2.73, what are the three numbers closest to the 0? 8, 13, and 21, right? Those are the closest to the 0, would you agree?
Yes.
2.73. What are the three numbers closest to the 0 on the 1.1?
13 and 21.
And now, if you look at your, you have another sheet that's got a reduction rate of 0.45%. Lots more numbers. Again, they're all in the same position rotationally. But what are the two closest to zero now?
34 and 21.
34 and 21, or maybe 34 and 13, it's hard to say. Yeah. Or maybe another way to ask this question is, which three other numbers make a square with zero?
21, 34, 41, 50, and 55,
right? 21, 34, and 55 and 0 make a nice square on the 0.45. On the 1.1, what makes a good square with 0?
21, 34,
13,
0, 21, 0. 34. Right? And on the 2.73, what makes a good square?
8, 21.
Right. Those are all Fibonacci numbers, but you'll notice that the less quickly I reduce, the bigger the Fibonacci numbers are that they connect with. And now the fourth sheet you have is going in the other direction. I'm reducing it quicker than 2.73. I'm reducing it 6%. And you don't get anything that's too square, but what's the most square-like thing you can make with zero there?
8, 13, and 5.
Right. Okay? So that's the difference in these three sheets, is the rate of reduction. And that determines how many spirals you're going to get. Because what if we go from 0 to 5 to 10 to 15, how many spirals will we end up with of that type? If it's 5 apart, we have how many spirals? 5. If it's 8 apart, we have 8 spirals, right? If it's 13 apart, we have 13 spirals. If you go up to... So anyway, so these sheets, these are for you to sort of play with. You can pick what you want to draw on these in terms of which spirals you want to fill in. You can fill in the ones that are the most obvious. Like, you tell me which two spirals are the most obvious on sheet, let's say, sheet 1.1%. What spirals do you actually see even before you connect them?
0, 21, 42.
Okay, so the 021 is one of them. What's the other one?
0, 13, 26.
0, 13. So this one really wants to be the 13, 21, right? And that's the one that's most obvious. I'm sorry?
8, 16, 24,
which, right? And the reason I made these is this is why the artichoke has, say, 5, 8, and the pine cone has 8, 13, and the sunflower has, you know, 34, 55, or whatever. It has to do with the rate of reduction or the rate of expansion you have to look at. That determines which numbers are closest to each other. So nature doesn't set out to make a certain number of spirals. The spirals are something that appear as a result of this same golden ratio technique that you've all been doing here. And it's just a matter of how quickly they expand or reduce. And that's what determines what shows. Yes.
But even some of the larger numbered spirals are still there. They're just closer and closer to straight lines.
That's right. All spirals are there at all times. It's just that certain ones are the obvious ones. It's really a perceptual thing. We see the spiral because we tend to connect dots in our vision system, basically, right? So they're all there, including the one spiral. Don't forget the one spiral. That's the one that you just did by hand. You did the 1, 0, 1, da, da, da. That's a spiral, too. It's a very, very roundabout spiral. Okay?
And if you've ever seen, I'm sure you have these documentations, stop action animation with a sunflower growing, it actually looks like they're moving out.
That's right, it looks like they're moving out, exactly.
On the spiral.
So, what I was saying, why don't you go ahead and on each of these sheets, you're welcome to do what you like, but my recommendation would be to draw the two spirals in the two directions that are most obvious on the given sheets. For the given reduction rate. okay? Again, there's no right answer, but from 1.1, most of us thought that the 21 and the 13 was the clearest one to do, the most obvious one. So you can do that. Is that clear? So just to maybe clarify further, if I had made this template, how could I have made this template make the same look as, say, the 6% one? What would be the difference here? This is the 2.73% one. I would just have to make these dots reduced by 6% rather than by 2.73%, and then if you use this template, you would end up with this sheet. It's all about the reduction rate for the same n. To do, which is, as a group, I'd like to each group take a, I have a translucent version of the 2.73, and what I want you to do is take your push pin, or your thumbtack, and take your opaque one and your translucent one, take your thumbtack, poke a hole through the center of each of them, making sure it's right in the center. Okay. Actually, Ben, wait a minute, I should have said, take your opaque sheet, poke the pinhole through the center of the opaque sheet, and attach it in the back, like that. Okay? And then take your transparent sheet, set that down, take your transparent sheet, and set it on top of that one, also on that pinhole, so that they line up perfectly. I haven't given it to you yet. And so I've got the two of them lined up like this now, and we're going to do something with rotating this and seeing what happens when you rotate it.
Which one are you using on the percentage?
The 2.73, and it's the lined one. Use the lined one for now. It doesn't have to be the lined one, but it might as well use the lined one. You've all got your two pieces, one on top of the other?
Yes.
Okay, I want you to rotate, first get them to the line up exactly, and then I want you to rotate them, rotate the top piece relative to the bottom piece, counterclockwise, until the zero of the top lines up with the one of the bottom. The zero of the top lines up with the one of the bottom.
They match.
Oh.
Yes. So notice that when you line it up, it's a little bit smaller than the one beneath it. Every dimension is a little bit smaller, except you've now got one pointing out. You see that? Or is it a little larger? Did I say that backwards?
Yeah, larger.
So you've got your zero. Here's your zero on the one. There's the one there.
Oh, yeah, slightly smaller.
So the one on top looks a little bigger than the one on bottom, except the one on top is missing one of the pieces.
Yeah.
You see that?
Yeah, good. Thank you.
Now try rotating the zero around to the two.
Yeah. Oh, wait, which one is the zero? The top zero?
The top zero under the bottom two. So now the top one looks even bigger than the bottom one.
Yeah.
How many pieces are missing? Two pieces. What happens if you rotate it again? Rotate it around to three. Basically, the shape, when you rotate it around, it's basically the same shape except missing one piece. A little bit bigger, but missing one piece. Or the other way you can think about it is the other one's a little smaller, but adds a piece. Let's rotate the other direction. So instead of lining up the top zero with the bottom one, let's line up the top one with the bottom zero. The top one to the bottom zero. What happens there?
Almost.
Yeah.
Now the bottom
the
one
bottom
is
missing, yeah.
But, bigger but.
A bigger butt. What
bigger,
are you talking
however,
about? Oh.
Bigger, however, it's bigger except what?
It's hanging out.
Actually, the top one is smaller, but it's got an extra piece.
Naughty.
Is that what you find?
Yes.
And how can you make the top one smaller still, but with two extra pieces? Any guesses? Try it, see if it works. Yeah.
So it doesn't function.
So how can you get four extra platforms? Extra pieces.
With four on top of it.
Yeah, I'm impressed. Yeah. Those were based on this exact same, the same fundamental geometry, and I'm just playing with various other parameters, but they're based on this remarkable system that nature uses for growing things and making them symmetrical and making them efficient for light gathering and for seed packing. And I hope you have a little better appreciation for what nature has done and is doing. And when you find yourself out in nature, be sure to look around, and if you see any spirals on any plants, count them, and for the vast majority of time, you'll find they're going to be Fibonacci numbers. One of the plants I didn't show that I should have shown because it's so common down here is the palm tree. If you look at the sides of many palm trees, you'll see those spiral formations. Go ahead and count them, and I think you know what you'll find. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you.